Students, in this class we will have discussions on action of a zone plate for the incident spherical wavefront. How the zone plate acts for incident spherical wavefront. So what is wavefront? This has been already discussed in the last class. This is the plane drawn perpendicular to the propagation of light. So if the source you are keeping at finite distance, then the wavefront, if you draw for that light coming from the source, then that wavefront is considered as the spherical wavefront. So here in the diagram, let us consider xy is there. Xy represents the section of the zone plate. This is section of zone plate which is perpendicular to the plane of the paper, or else you can call that perpendicular to the propagation of incident light. Then S is the point source of light. S is point source of light. P is the position of the screen for a bright image. So at point P, let us suppose here a screen is placed for the bright image. And A is the distance of the source from the source. A is the distance of the source to the zone plate. So here zone plate is there. Distance from the source to the zone plate is A. And B is the distance of the screen from the zone plate. So here this B distance represents distance from the zone plate to the screen. Let OM1, OM2, OM3, these represents the radii of first, second and third half period zone. So here this distance OM represents radius of the first half period zone, and the distance OM2 represent from here to here, this represents radius of the second half period zone. OM3, that represents radius of the third half period zone, and this continues. So from one half period zone to next half period zone, the path difference we are maintaining is lambda by 2. Like that the zone periods are constructed, that's why the name half period zones. So one half period zone to next half period zone, the path difference maintained is lambda by 2. Thus from the figure what we can write is the distance SO plus OP, SO to OP, this distance will be equal to A plus B. This we have considered. Then the distance SM1 plus M1P. So this becomes equal to SM1 plus M1P. This becomes equal to, so this is the central point from here to first half period zone. So how much path difference, means how much extra distance that the ray is going to travel, is lambda by 2. So with respect to the center, the distance that the light ray is traveling is A plus B. Then from the first half period zone, SM1, M1P, the distance becomes equal to A plus B will be there. In addition to this, how much extra path difference the rays are traveling is lambda by 2. So SM1, M1P, that distance becomes equal to A plus B plus lambda by 2. In the same manner, SM2 plus M2P, that becomes equal to A plus B will be there plus 2 lambda by 2, means lambda will be there. So this I will denote as lambda only, and this continues, so on. Now from the triangle SM1O, let us consider this triangle SM1O. From triangle SM1O we can write as SM1 is equal to, this distance becomes equal to SO square plus OM1 square raised to 1 by 2. So this I will write as SO square plus OM1 square raised to 1 by 2. Apply the Pythagoras theorem so that you are going to get the distance SO. Already we have considered that as A. So SO becomes equal to A, that is A square, plus OM1 is the radius of the first half period zone. So that I am going to denote by R1. So this is R1 square raised to 1 by 2. This is the value of SM1. Then similarly from the triangle OM1P, what we can write is M1P, the distance M1P is equal to this distance because in order to substitute the value of this S M1 and M1P, I have to find the values of S M1 and M1P. Then from the triangle, this M1OP, M1P becomes equal to this OP square plus OM1 square. The square of this and OM1 square raised to 1/2. So OP we have considered as M1P becomes equal to OP is B, this is B square plus again OM1 is R1 only, this is R1 square raised to 1/2. So this is the value of S M1 and M1P. So now substitute these two values in the above equation. Call this as equation 1, this as equation 2. Okay, so substitute the values of S M1 and M1P in the equation 2. So what we are going to get is S M1 is A square plus R1 square raised to 1/2 plus M1P is B square plus R1 square raised to 1/2, and that is equal to A plus B plus λ/2. So this will be A plus B plus λ/2. So now from this bracket I will take this A square common. So if you take A square common from the bracket, raised to 1/2 is there, that becomes equal to A. If you take A square common, it becomes A. Here 1 will be there, 1 plus R1 square divided by, this is A square raised to 1/2 plus, again from this I will take B square common, raised to 1/2 is there, that becomes equal to B plus B into 1 plus R1 square divided by B square whole raised to 1/2, that is equal to A plus B plus λ/2. So now we have to simplify this. This bracket term is of the form 1 plus x raised to n. So this series, if you expand, means what you are going to get is 1 plus x whole raised to n. You can write as 1 plus nx plus n into n minus 1 divided by 2 factorial into x square plus n into n minus 1 into n minus 2 divided by 3 factorial into x cube. So that I will apply here in place of n, 1/2 is there. So here this bracket term is of the form 1 plus x raised to 1/2. This is of the form this. So if you expand this, what you are going to get is 1 plus 1/2 x minus 1/8 x square plus 1/16 x cube minus 1/2 x. This is the expansion of this series. So this I will apply to this bracket term. In place of x we are having R1 square divided by A square. So if we simplify this, only first two terms I am going to consider and the remaining terms are very small. That's why I am going to neglect those terms. So if you expand the bracket term, so what you are going to have is 1 as it is into this A, that becomes equal to A plus 1/2 will be there, 1/2 R1 square A square will be there into this A, R1 square A square into this A. So 1 A get cancels out, you are left with only R1 square divided by this 2A, and the remaining terms are very small, so that I will neglect. Then the same thing I am going to apply for the next bracket, that is 1 plus R1 square divided by B square. So if we apply and multiply this with B, so we are having B plus R1 square divided by 2B. Remaining terms are neglected. So which is equal to A plus B plus λ/2. So here A and B are there on both the sides, so that becomes equal to 0, and we are left with only this R1 square divided by 2A plus R1 square divided by 2B, which is equal to λ/2. So now from these two terms I can take R1 square divided by 2 common. If you take R1 square divided by 2 common, you are left with only 1/A plus 1/B, and that is equal to λ/2. 2 get cancels out and we are left with only this r1 square into bracket 1 by a plus 1 by b, and that is equal to lambda. Here for the nth half period zone, r1 is for the first half period zone, so this I can extend for the nth half period zone. In generally, if I write the expression and if I write for rn is equal to, then the same thing we are going to get rn square into bracket 1 by a plus 1 by b, and that is equal to, for the first half period zone 1 lambda will be there, for the nth half period zone n lambda will be there. So here for the distance a and b, we have to apply the sign conventions because we have not considered any sign conventions till now. So by applying the sign conventions, what we are going to get is the distance a becomes minus. Why? Because always all the distances in optics are measured from the center point, that is from the pole. So if you measure from the pole the distance a up to the source, if you go means we have to go in a direction opposite to the incident ray direction. So if you are going in a direction opposite to the incident light, then that distances are considered as negative. So a becomes equal to minus a, and the distance b, so from the O we have to start and we have to go up to the point P. So if you start from the O, then we are going in a direction of the incident light, then the distance b becomes equal to b only. So now by applying the sign conventions, this distance becomes equal to rn square into bracket 1 by b minus 1 by a, which is equal to n lambda. The same expression if I write for 1 by b minus 1 by a means 1 by b minus 1 by a, that becomes equal to n lambda divided by this rn square. In the previous derivation, so value of this is known, n lambda divided by rn square, that is rn square divided by n lambda, this becomes equal to focal length for the nth half period zone. So n lambda divided by rn square becomes equal to 1 divided by fn. So now this 1 by b minus 1 by a, this I can write as 1 by fn, since this fn is equal to rn square divided by n lambda. So now look at this equation, 1 by b minus 1 by a is equal to 1 by f. This is similar to the equation 1 by v minus 1 by u is equal to 1 by f. In the case of lenses, we have got this, that is 1 by v minus 1 by u, that is equal to 1 by f, where v is the image distance, u is the object distance, f is the focal length. In the similar manner, so here in place of v, b is there, b is distance from the center to the screen where we are going to place, a is distance from the center of the zone to the object, that is from where we are going to start the rays. F is same. So by comparing these two equations, what we can conclude is zone plate is there, that zone plate acts as the converging lens. Zone plate acts as the converging lens means that is convex lens only. A zone plate has number of foci. Number of foci depends on the number of zones used as well as the wavelength of light employed. So now from these two, by comparing these two equations, so the conclusion is zone plate acts as the convex lens. So now we'll compare this zone plate and the convex lens. What are the comparison between zone plate and the convex lens? So both zone plate and the convex lens, they form the real image of the object. Both are going to form the real image, and the equation connecting the conjugate distances are similar. So both the equations are similar. So in the case of zone plate, we have got 1 by f is equal to 1 by b minus 1 by a, and in the case of convex lens, there is 1 by f is equal to 1 by b minus 1 by u. Equations connecting the conjugate distances are same, and both are going to form the real image. Then the second is, in both the cases, the focal length depends on the wavelength of light used. So if composite light you are going to use means, composite light means the number of wavelength will be there. So all the rays, all the wavelengths are going to focus at a different points on the screen. Means that is clear image of the object is not visible, and that kind of aberration or a defect is called as chromatic aberration. So both are going to suffer from the chromatic aberration because the focal length in both the cases depends on the wavelength of light used. This is the second comparison. Third one is, in case of a zone plate, the image formation is due to the diffraction phenomenon. So here the diffraction takes place, and because of that only the image formation takes place in the case of zone plate. But in the case of convex lens, because of refraction of light, the image formation takes place. So light ray is going to bend, and because of that image formation takes place. That is in the case of convex lens. Both works are same only, but the phenomenon corresponding to these two are different. Then the fourth comparison is, zone plate is having multiple foci on either side. So zone plate, in the case of zone plate, number of foci we are having on either side of the zone plate. So that's why the intensity is less in this case. The intensity of the image formed will be less. But in the case of convex lens, it is having only one focus, and all the light is focused at one point, and the intensity of the image will be more. Next comparison is, in case of zone plate, between two zones, consecutive zones, the path difference between the rays is, light rays is lambda by 2 will be there. Between two zones, consecutive zones, the path difference between the light rays will be lambda by 2. But in the case of convex lens, all the rays meet at one point, hence the path difference will be 0 in the case of convex lens. Next, last comparison is, zone plate we can use over a wide range of wavelengths, starting from the microwaves to the x-rays, whereas glass lens, this cannot be used beyond visible region. Up to visible region we can use the glass lens, beyond visible we are not supposed to use the glass lens. So this is regarding the comparison of zone plate and the convex lens. So here completes this. You take the assignment question, students. Explain the action of zone plate and compare it with convex lens. Thank you.